Whoa, we are live. We are on so many platforms now. It takes a moment to fire this bad boy up. Welcome into the Raheel Show podcast, Monday Night Chats with Jose Partida. This is going to be our busiest Monday show that I can remember, Jose. We have a lot to talk about. First, we're going to start with The Watchmen and bring on Michael Carrell from Comicast Podcast and our brother in radio. You still work with him. I no longer work with him. I miss him so much, you know, because I still talk to you once a week. Right. I don't get a chance to talk to Michael as much. He is the hardest working man in radio. He's going to join us in a few minutes. We'll talk to him about The Watchmen. We'll talk to him about some other superhero news that was here on the Raheel Show podcast with David Nuno on Sunday. So we'll talk about that as well regarding the Batman and Michael Keaton. Hello. He's going to be the new Nick Fury of the DC universe, according to Umberto, who covers the comic book scene and movies and all that. So we'll talk a little bit about that. We'll dig into that. Then we have one of our loyal listeners, StrosFanIKnow. That's his original Twitter handle. We don't know his real name. We don't know him other than his Twitter account. He is one of the most fascinating guys and one of the funniest guys. So he's going to be joining us towards the end of this show. And we are going to talk some nonsense with him. We're going to talk about kolaches with him because it's his mission to clear up what is a kolache and what is not a kolache. So that's going to be on the show today. Jose, how you been, man? How's your week going so far?
Well, I'm excited, man, to have MC on. I've been all right. I powered through all of Watchmen, and then I powered through the movie this weekend. So I'm excited to talk about them with Michael. Everything else is about the same, man. Trying to stay out of trouble, trying to stay away from people because Texas don't know how to act. But,
man. We took a huge step backwards. We took a magnificent step backwards. Now, look, I can't be complaining too much because here I am in a pandemic traveling, going to the airport and all of that. But I've stayed at home for free. I've stayed at home and I haven't interacted with anybody. Even my neighbors, I'm keeping like 20 feet from them just to be safe.
Yeah.
And I can't dog on people too much because I'm over here living my best life and traveling. But can you talk about what happened to you? Is it official? Can we talk about it?
Oh man, we haven't talked about it, huh?
No, because
I can't believe we didn't mention it yesterday. We had Jermaine on last week, right? So that's why we didn't get a chance to talk about it. So I had to get tested for COVID-19 2 weeks ago now, I think it was, two Fridays ago. And it was a very unpleasant experience. I was fine the whole time. I had a headache here and there that I think was maybe part of like the anxiety of like, oh crap, is this part of the virus? Just like the uncertainty of it. I thought I got it from one of my family members. There's a big spread on my mom's side of the family. And I thought my brother and I might have it. We both got tested the same day. We both came back negative. But that test is very unpleasant. So
the one that digs deep in, right?
Because both
there's
nostrils.
Some new tests. Okay, both nostrils.
Both nostrils. Yeah.
Wow, you got the super poor one.
Yeah. it was pretty expensive too. It was $250.
Wow.
Luckily, my insurance covered most of it, and my job paid the rest. So,
you came back negative, but you still quarantined, right? You had to quarantine.
Yeah, I had to stay home for 5 days. I got tested on Friday. I didn't go back to work till Thursday. Yeah. I got my results on Tuesday.
So, man, to get a public test, by the way, it is really hard to get one.
No, my group of childhood best friends, two of them have it, and the idiots have been all hanging out together here and there sporadically. And all of them had to go get tested. And one of them had to had his test today, and he has been waiting to take his test for over a week now.
What?
Because he couldn't find the city. That's just the test date he was assigned. His roommate, one of my other best friends, had his test on last Wednesday. So they both called the same day, which was two Fridays. I got tested two Fridays ago. So last Friday, they both called. He didn't. One of my friends had it this Wednesday that just passed, and then the other one had it today.
Dude,
it's crazy, man. And now the federal government's pulling funding for it in Texas. It's just absurd.
So I signed up on the Fort Bend website to get one done because I just wanted to be sure I don't have it. If I, you know, if I do have it, then I know I can continue quarantining. If I don't have it, then I can, you know, continue quarantining because that's what's happening anyways. But I signed up and the process is the following. You go there, you answer some questions. And I, look, I checked everything that was more towards the, it's not a panic. Okay. I just want to get it done because I'm not sure. It took me, first of all, the form took like a minute, but they still haven't contacted me to set up a date. And even after that, you still have to go the next day. And then it takes 3 to 5 days to get your results. So, I mean, by that time, it's like, well, just go ahead and write it out, right? Like, what's the point of getting this done? And they say it, if you are ill, then go to the hospital. If you're not, then just stay home. Like, literally, there's nothing else you can do. It's that simple. So, fascinating stuff on your part. Luckily, you don't have it. And I don't know if I have it or not. We'll find out when I eventually get this test.
In like 2 weeks. Check in 2 Mondays from now.
It's like at that point, I don't even want to waste a public test, right? Because it's already been a week since I've traveled. So what's the point? I can wait another week. By the time I get my results, it'll be 2.5 weeks. So just a little COVID-19 update to let you know what it's like to get a public test. And I do have health insurance because my wife, I jumped on her health insurance, which is awesome. She works for a medical company, so it's really easy. But I just wanted to see what the process was like. So a little COVID-19 talk. All right, we're making our guest wait, and I don't like that because he is the hardest working man in the freaking business. Michael Carrell. He's finally on. Hold on, Michael. Hold on. We might get kicked off of YouTube when we do this, but I'm still going to play it, so I don't care because this is our song for you, and it's my beloved Me and Michael song.
Me and Michael. Solid
as makeup.
Me and Michael. Me and Michael.
Okay, that was good. That was good.
I love that song. That is for real one of my favorite MGMT songs because of you now, Michael.
Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate it. I'm happy.
Do you remember the first time I heard that song? I came into your office. I was like, Michael, I've got a theme song for our friendship, and I blasted this in your studio. How about this, Michael? Did. If you're listening on the audio side, Michael Carrell is still at the office. What about Michael? Go home.
I can't. Why? I got stuff to do.
Who cares?
Also, I realized how late it was, and I was like, "Oh, I'll be on the road," and this whole thing.
Oh no! Now Michael's gonna be at the office for another 25 minutes.
He's gonna guilt trip us now.
I'm sorry.
I wasn't going to, but now.
Michael, how you been, man?
I've been good, man. Just, you know, busy as you could tell, but it's been good. I've been good. It's good seeing you. I haven't seen you in a while.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Wasn't talking to you. No.
Have you gotten COVID-19 from Jose yet? He's over here super spreading.
Not yet. I mean, it's been close a couple times, but not yet, thankfully.
Okay, who would be one person at the station if you did catch COVID-19 from that you wouldn't be too upset about? Like, and let's say you're not going to be asymptomatic, but you're not going to be hospitalized either. You're going to struggle. Okay.
Okay.
It's going to suck for 10 days. All right. But you'll be fine. Okay. You're going to come out. Okay. We're going to go no permanent lung damage either.
Okay.
So I'm just laying this out for you. Now, who is the one person, if you figure it out and they go, look, it's 100% you got it from X, you wouldn't be mad at?
I guess Beautiful Andrew, just because he's beautiful. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't be upset with that.
Oh, geez. Okay, Michael. I was hoping you'd say me.
Jeez. I mean, you're right here. I felt like that would be like, you know, I don't know.
That would be the most.
Is this a bad time to tell you I tested positive and you probably have it?
This is a very bad time. This is a very bad time.
We'll save this for tomorrow then.
Beautiful Andrew would be the best COVID-19 ever.
It would make sense. It would make sense because he doesn't wash his hands or disinfect anything. So,
exactly.
And that's a very believable example.
And I'm pretty sure he was at Spire last night as well because that's how beautiful
the
Andrew
wall of shame.
The wall of shame. Yeah. All right, Michael Carrell, we only have you for a little bit because I know you want to get home. So you recommended you recommended The Watchmen to us, and it took me forever to get to The Watchmen.
It did.
You know, I heard about the show. I watch everything you recommend. I finally had a free Saturday night, and I was like, Michael, what was the show you recommended to me? What was it? And we went back and forth. I was like, was it Umbrella Academy? Was it something else? Yeah. And then finally, you're like, I think it was The Watchmen. And I started it, and holy crap. And then Jose copied me, of course. And I was just like, come on, bro.
I didn't completely copy. I copied the tweet. Well, I already had the intentions of watching. I just copied the tweet because it would be funny. And damn, was it funny.
It was pretty funny. So, Michael, we're late to the party. Tell us, what was the critical reception of that show from, one, the mainstream, and then, two, from the diehards who loved the Watchmen movie or the graphic novels?
I think critically it was pretty well received when it launched. It was, and right away, for I think a lot of journalists and a lot of people up there for their favorite show of the year. I know it was my favorite show of the year last year. And I think with mainstream or like fans and stuff, I think they liked it as well. I think it did a great job of enhancing what you got from the comics and what you got from, if you read the comic beforehand, because I didn't read the comic before the show. I just started recently reading the comic to get a better sense. Like, I kind of knew stuff going into the show, but I didn't know everything. But I think most people like really enjoyed the show.
So it's such a good show. In 9 episodes, I felt like it left a little bit on the table. I wanted more of it, and they've already had conversations about whether or not there'll be a second season, and most of it is there won't be another season. Yeah. But what did you feel it did better than the movie? And was there anything you thought the movie did better? Because frankly, I watched the movie this weekend and I didn't care much for it.
Honestly, like I was telling you, I watched the movie in theaters back in 2009. And I just remember it being like a slog. I didn't really enjoy it that much. There was a lot of blue penis. I mean, that was, you know, that was a lot to handle.
How much is too much? Penis?
Hold on. HBO was not shy either with the dong. No,
they weren't.
Oh, no, they weren't. Definitely not. It's just, it was one thing when it's on a screen that's like, you know, 30 feet, whatever it is.
That's a good point.
You know, but like the movie, like, honestly, it was okay. Like, I know it did some things and it adapted some of the stuff from the comic. Okay. But I don't know. It just didn't feel, I don't know. It was boring to get through. Honestly, it wasn't very interesting. And I don't know. I didn't care for the movie too much, but the show, I think the show builds on what's happening like right now in society in major, major ways. And I think it adds to the lore of the comic, and like what they do with Hooded Justice is like, I think brilliant. I think it's really great what they do. And I love how Damon Lindelof, he was the creator of the show. I love how he approached it, because I feel like you could have done a lot of easy things and included Dr. Manhattan like from the jump. You could have included Ozymandias from the jump. Like, you could have done a lot of things. And the way they unrolled the series was just brilliant, I think. I think they just did a spectacular job. And going back to what you said, Jose, I think it is going to be only one season. I don't think they do another season. And I'm okay with that. I'm 100% okay with it.
Yeah, like what else is there to add, right? Because there was a good twist at the end. It built most of the characters up to the point where you felt like they were fleshed out enough. For me, at least, it was. And what do you want from season two? Like, I don't want to spoil it too much because I know a lot of people are going to go watch this after they listen to the show. There's nothing in season two that intrigues me about how they left it. And like, if the story is going to revolve around that person, I'm good. I think it was, you're right. Like, I don't think it demands a season two, unlike other shows where there's still a lot left.
No. Yeah. I'm completely fine with the one season. I thought the
I think there's
Michael, I think you're on the station's crappy Wi-Fi.
You are.
Yeah. You got to switch your Wi-Fi up, bro.
Damn, get your Wi-Fi up game. Get your Wi-Fi game up, MC.
Come on, Gal Media.
So what I was trying to say, the sixth episode, the Nostalgia Hood of Justice episode, was one of the best episodes of television I've seen in such a long time. Like the flashbacks with Angela going back and forth with that, and I just wanted to see him kill Nazis for an hour. Like it was such a good episode. That was like, I couldn't believe I was watching that and how good that episode was. And the thing that I love the most about the show was the social commentary and like how subliminal a lot of it was. And one of the things that to me that stuck out was in this episode, how this whole time Hood of Justice is black, and there's in the current timeline of the show, there is a show being made about Hood of Justice where he's played as a white man. Well, the whole time everyone thought that Hood of Justice was the white man, right? But we know in real life he wasn't. And to me, that was kind of like an indictment of how we whitewash a lot of media. And I guess you could say, well, everyone thought Hood of Justice was a white man. But if that's the case, like, how did everyone know he was gay as well? Like, that was another big thing with the Hood of Justice character that no one knew, but the show somehow knew about it. Like, I thought that was a very interesting thing about that one particular episode. Looks like we lost Michael.
Michael, you there?
I'm here. I don't know if you can hear me.
We can't see you. We could hear you, but we can't see you.
Okay, I see Michael now. I see him. Okay, so he's back. He's back with us. Michael, with this show, it was interesting, you know, as Jose pointed out, the social commentary, they pull you in with the first episode. They teach you about what happened in Tulsa, and that's been a huge thing about everything that's been happening in terms of the history, and like nobody learned about this. And it took a comic book show or graphic novel show to teach people about what happened in Tulsa. And I don't want to go dig too deep into it right now because I think when you learn about it in the show, it's actually really well done. But they pull you in with that, and then they get super nerdy into it. And I wonder, like, how many people actually finish the show because you're like, oh, this is going to be one thing. And then it gets super nerdy.
Yeah, I think that probably would have tripped a lot of people up, especially if you don't have a lot of knowledge of the comic. But I don't know. I think you lure people. Well, I guess the big thing about the comic is it does sit a lot into historical fiction. So if you're into historical fiction, then this is the show for you. But they do tie in a lot of what actually happened. Obviously, like you mentioned with the Tulsa massacre, but I think, I don't know, it's a show that works. And if you kind of get past some of the weird stuff, I think most anybody will enjoy it.
Michael, do this. Go ahead and close the tab, reconnect your Wi-Fi, and then rejoin us because Gal Media just went cheap on the Wi-Fi again. So we're going to have to kick him out. He's
Gal Media sabotaging Raheel's career once again.
Man, it's too soon, Jose.
Those sons of bitches.
Some say I'm free now. I can spread my wings, maybe. Who knows? The nostalgia episode was so great, man. That tied everything together because up until that point, it was a really good show. The music was fantastic. The acting was really good. It was giving you just enough of the storyline without getting too much.
Yeah. But then
it got to the point before that episode where I was like, okay, I'm so damn confused right now. I have no idea what's happening in terms of who's who and what's happening. And then that episode tied everything up.
Yeah, perfectly. It tied everything together, even the fictional sitcom, the fictional drama that everyone's watching, to the point where, if you notice, the very first the first time Hood of Justice encounters a Klan in episode 6 is the reverse of what happens in that first episode of the TV show where he goes through the glass into the shop to fight the burglars. Well, what really happened was he came in through the back from fighting the Nazis and he escaped the shop through that window he jumped through in the show. I thought that was incredible. The way they did that.
Yeah. Michael, other thoughts on the show that we haven't hit?
No, I mean, it's just, I hope just everyone watches it because, again, it's a fascinating, it's a really great show that people should watch. And it at the same time teaches you stuff. It does so many things interesting, ties so much into what's happening now. I mean, it's just such a great, great show that people should definitely check out.
And it makes sense why all those things you just mentioned, the timing is almost chilling. And it makes sense why HBO made it free, put it in front of its paywall. So those of you who might be listening today who don't have HBO, well, you should be able to find it ahead of their paywall. I don't know the technicalities of how they do it, of how you would do that, but
it's free everywhere. Like
they've announced it
on Hulu, on DirecTV.
Oh, really? Okay.
On the HBO app, you literally go to that and play it and it plays. There's no hoops around it for
how many episodes? Or anything. It's nine episodes.
For nine episodes, we're all millionaires and we can all afford HBO. It's nice. Michael, the thing about this show that frustrates me is I don't think it took off until what happened in last month because of the tweets about, hey, we didn't even learn about Tulsa until The Watchmen. Now, people were talking about it. You guys on Comicast obviously were big fans of it. You were telling us about it. But it never got the mainstream run, I feel, that it did until the last month. With all of the racial injustice protests and information that was being put out there, why didn't it take off initially? It's such a good show.
I think it's the IP, honestly. Watchmen is not... Most people, when you say Watchmen, they think of the movie from 2009. Mm-hmm. And it's just not a well-known big-name IP compared to something like, I don't know, like Superman or anything like that. Even though it's still an HBO show, I think it still flew under the radar for most fans. And, it's while it's kind of disappointing at the same time, I'm glad just people are discovering it now, rather than like never watching it. I'm just glad people are watching it right now, honestly.
That's a good point you make, because when I would hear about the show before I started watching it, when it was generally conversations with you. And when you would try to explain it to me, you'd tell me like, oh, it's a show based off of the graphic novel, but the characters from the graphic novel aren't in it. It's based now when the graphic novel was based in the 80s. And that was kind of confusing, frankly. So imagine someone who has no idea what The Watchmen is and trying to tell them, hey, it's based on this graphic novel, but they're not really in it. It's totally unrelated and it's set in current times. Like, I can understand the disconnect with that, but it's definitely worth the time.
Okay, so from 2019,
definitely is
from 2019. Better show, The Mandalorian or The Watchmen?
Ooh, MC,
The Watchmen.
Whoa,
The Watchmen.
Wow, thanks.
Yeah, no,
It's you know really Disney good. Runs everything, right?
Wow.
You
do know that, right, Michael? We just lost our Disney check. Thanks, wow. Michael.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks.
I'm sorry.
Raheel doesn't have a job, Michael. Okay.
Wow.
Jeez.
Disney runs everything.
When I said Watchmen, I meant Mandalorian.
You know, Disney owns ABC 13, and I do stuff for ABC 13. So thanks, Michael. Just taking
that. Ozark season 3 or Watchmen.
Watchmen.
Ozark season 3.
Or Watchmen. I'm going Watchmen.
Answer the question, Michael.
Oh, Ozark season 3, I guess. Yeah.
Wrong answer.
Wrong answer. Do you know who owns the Watchmen?
Disney.
Warner Brothers? Oh.
Hey, Michael, what have you guys been talking about on Comicast? Because everything's been on hold right now. There was the big news of Michael Keaton returning as the Batman in The Flash. They're going to introduce the multiverse, and we had Umberto on with us yesterday. So if you want to listen to that interview, and he did hint at this, that Michael Keaton's Batman is potentially lining up to be the Nick Fury of DCU's future, because they're going to redo Justice League, and he's going to be the old veteran leading the group and not necessarily fighting.
Right. Yeah, I mean... With that addition, I think, one, it's stunning. Two, I think it's a fascinating way to utilize the character all these years later. because now they're really, like Umberto was talking about, they're really leaning into this multiverse idea, and it's allowing them to finally tell standalone stories and not worry about connecting everything. Just focus on telling us good stories and give us good content. And I think just adding this new caveat with Michael Keaton, I think it's an interesting thing because it's going to get people excited. He's not necessarily my Batman, but he's still, I think for some people, he's still Batman to them. So I think it's a great addition, and it opens the doors to so many possibilities with him, with DC. It's smart what they're doing now, honestly. Instead of doing what they were doing with Man of Steel, Batman versus Superman, all that, lean into this multiverse idea and just go hard with it, because you can tell so many stories.
Do you think they should have started somewhere else other than with Flashpoint, or is Flashpoint the only way you get there? Because Flashpoint is the most important Flash storyline, and you're starting with that. Like, is there room for them to do something else with Flash if you're starting with with his biggest story?
That's my concern, is that, you know, if, like, my initial concern is when I heard Flashpoint was the first movie, I was like, wow, that's a big story to tell for your first movie out the gate. And we haven't gotten any time with Ezra Miller's Flash, really. I mean, we've gotten it in Batman versus Superman a little, Justice League a lot, but still, it was never focused on him. So we haven't really gotten that character development. So when you open up with Flashpoint, it does do a lot for the multiverse, but for Flash himself as a character, I guess that's my concern, is how do they balance the story with telling a good story for the character? You know, if you have all these characters, if you have Keaton, if you have Gal Gadot, if you have Jason Momoa, is that going to be too much? I get what it's trying to do to maybe reset the universe, but at the same time, you have to tell a good Flash story. They'll have to pare it down, I imagine. And I can't imagine they go super crazy with it. So
I guess my follow-up is what Raheel just put on the board, which is a question from our boy Sammy. Wasn't the speculation about Flash being recast after the choking incident? Was there a choking incident with the Flash actor? Are they just sweeping it under the rug? And I wanted to pair that with what I can't believe, because they've had to hire a new director for Flash, right? I can't imagine that was the original plan for the first Flash movie, right? So are they blowing it all up and starting all over?
Well, Flash has been like in development hell for like a while now. It was supposed to come out. I mean, we got a date for it. It was supposed to come out this year, I think. It was at one point dated for 2020, and it's gone through, I don't remember offhand how many directors, but the latest director is the director for It, Andy Muschietti, I believe. And it's, there was a point where Ezra Miller was like, he was going to like just write it himself. There was what with the fan or whatever. It was like, oh, this dude, he's already been in like had some issues behind the scenes reportedly. So now it's like, maybe they will recast him, but they seem dead set on using him, especially because he's kind of engaged with the studio already with Fantastic Beasts.
All right, Michael, promote the podcast, man. What do you guys have on it? Oh, no, he dropped off right there.
So
he is.
Comic-Cast, it comes out every Tuesday and Thursday.
What happened? Did we lose him, Raheel?
I think he got hit with delays. Michael, say it again. What's on Comic-Cast?
Okay, Comic-Cast is every Tuesday and Thursday. You can find it on all your favorite podcast platforms. I hope this is working right now. I have no idea. But you can find it on all your favorite podcast platforms. It's me alongside John Lee. And we talk all the latest news, and we talk anything pop culture and gaming and all kinds of stuff. And then you can also catch our YouTube videos on Comic-Cast video. Just search Comic-Cast on YouTube and subscribe, and that's it.
All right, there he is. Michael Carrell, man, thank you so much for staying late and joining us on the show. Really excited to talk with you. And next time we'll get you on with better Wi-Fi and maybe we can have a live conversation.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see. Way to drop the ball.
Yeah, Michael.
I know. I dropped it.
You should have got. You should have got to the Culture Map Wi-Fi. They get real Wi-Fi. We don't get real Wi-Fi on the radio side.
Next time.
Hey, man. Thank you so much, Michael. I appreciate it. And make sure you guys download the podcast. Search it. It's also in the description of this episode. Great guys, Michael. Love you, brother, man. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you guys. Appreciate you guys so much. I appreciate
love you, y'all. MC.
Boom. Hardest working man in radio. Friend. He really is.
Wish he had the like, Wi-Fi was, to equate that. Jesus.
Dude, my dude was still at the station. How about that? He was still at the station.
I felt really bad when his screen loaded it. I saw he was still at the station. We're working on a big project at the station, and of course he's doing most of the heavy lifting. So
ooh. What is it? Tell me. Ooh. Tell break it right here.
Ooh, I can't tell you. I can't tell you. Ooh.
I just saw that. I saw Granado and Lance and Dell. Are they off this week or something? Because or Dell's off this week. I don't know what's happening.
They banished me from that station. So
oh, good. Good. You're all right. You'll be okay. Hey, did you see the report? I put this on my Instagram. By the way, follow at Raheel doing things on Instagram. I'm putting up some headlines. I'm putting up random content, clips from the show, everything. Make sure you follow it. I'm going to have exclusive information on there about the Spicy Boy masks. They're officially coming in. They're just on their way in right now. They've been shipped. It's just going to take a few days, and I'll have information how you can buy the Spicy Boy mask. But did you see Apple, the iPhone 12, they announced it. And they had their big conference last week. I guess because I was driving, I missed it all. And there's a lot of big updates coming. The Apple Watch is finally going to get a sleep app, which is how do you like forget that? How do you just not make a sleep app? Fitbit has it. Everybody has it. And then they introduced grouping and putting stuff on the homepage from apps that Android had like 10 years ago. So they basically are way behind, but it's still a superior phone, in my opinion, having used both ecosystems. But the new thing is they're not even going to throw in headphones, which is fine. Like, do you use your Apple headphones?
I do use them, but I have like three of them at this point, so I don't need another pair.
Yeah, I've never even plugged in my wired headphones except for one time to test them out.
Okay, money bags.
Because no, once you get Bluetooth headphones, why do you have wired headphones, right? Like what's the point?
Okay, money bags, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, get some Bluetooth headphones.
You got the best internet over there and the Bluetooth headphones. I'm sorry. We don't live in your world, are you?
This is all paid by the Texas Unemployment Fund. Don't worry, Jose. But I like, dude, if anybody wants wired headphones, shoot your boy a DM. I'll send them to you because I literally have four of them sitting there because we don't use them. And it's, you know, like it's all about Bluetooth or AirPods if you have them. My wife has AirPods. She's the real money bag. So if they're not including headphones, which is I thought that was going to be the case, but they're not even including a charger anymore. How about that?
That's what I don't like, especially when you consider how fragile a lot of their chargers are. And mm-hmm. like they always rip. They rip within like 2 months. So I am not with that at all.
Yeah, and like the wires are, I don't even use my factory wire anymore because I lost you. I bought the wires that are like fast charging wires, and they're like $3 for $9 on Amazon, and you get those and you plug those in. But the actual bricks, the charging bricks, I do use those. And the fact that Apple's getting rid of those and they're gonna make you buy that's the most Apple thing ever. It is so Apple that they're gonna upcharge you on everything when they're already making you pay so much for the phone. They're like, nope, we can still make a little bit more. Maybe you want the dessert. Okay. You already spent all this money on the meal, but maybe you want the dessert. Can we sell you on a dessert to go? Maybe. And that's what they're doing at this point. It's like, dude, come on, you made so much money. And I don't know the financials, but I can predict it right now. I bet you Apple made a ton of money off of apps and in-app upgrades because of everyone sitting around. Everyone's sitting around. Kids are at home. Kids are playing games, and they're purchasing all this, and they've had to have made so much money off of that. I know they're not selling as much hardware because everything's closed. Factories are closing down, all that. But, man, the ecosystem upgrades within the last 3 months, it's got to be phenomenal.
So how far are we from that phone? Is that a turnaround that we get at the end of this year?
I believe so. It's going to be the same timeline.
Oh, hell.
Yeah,
I believe just got so. This phone. I just Which got the 11. I got the 11 a couple months ago. Here's the thing about me. My parents humbled me really soon. I had a crappy Nokia brick phone, not the meme brick Nokia phone. It was a touchscreen Nokia phone from 11th grade to my sophomore year of college. So yeah. I had my first iPhone my sophomore year of college in like 2014. And I think that was the 5 plus. And I had that for like 2 years. Then I got the 7, and I had the 7 from the 7 plus till I had to get this 11 because my 7 plus stopped working.
Because all that money was weighing you down?
Because I'm not one of those upgrade every year kind of guys. So that won't affect me now, but you can bet your ass they're never going to. Once they go to, you don't get a charger with your phone, they're not going back.
Oh, no, absolutely not. I the one thing I always recommend to people is go get a refurbished iPhone. Don't buy a brand new one, because for the most part, they're awesome phones, right? Like even the refurbished ones. And you can usually go to your local phone store and talk to the people there and ask them like, hey, do you have any deals on refurbs, or do you know anybody that does? And man, I've done a refurbished phone for the last 5 phones. And the only issue I've had is my wife's iPhone 7. That one, the motherboard crapped out. And I took it to Apple and they're like, dude, this rarely happens, but it happened to you. And sorry, we can't do anything. But we can give you $30 for it. And I was like, no, I'm not. No, you know what? I'm just going to hold on to this and sell the parts, because I'm not giving you $30 in credit for a new phone when I can go buy a used one. And sure enough, you know what I did? I took my old iPhone 7, took her iPhone 7 screen, had my friend on Harwin merge it, and we made a robot. And her phone has worked perfectly. We took my motherboard, her beautiful screen, and we made an iPhone baby, and it works.
You made an iPhone baby.
Yeah. So that's what I've been, you know, like I never want to buy a brand new iPhone. It's $1,000. Like, that's just too much. What are you guys doing?
You just wasted all your money on good Wi-Fi. You don't have money to get a new phone.
No, I don't. Actually, we get free Wi-Fi. What's up?
What?
Yeah. Work at home. How baby. Do you get... She works from home. How do you...
Oh, damn it.
Yeah, they credit for Wi-Fi. That's how it works. When you work at home, the company pays for the Wi-Fi. So your boy is just doing everything for free. All right, that's how it is. That's how I'm rolling right now. Okay, other things that we missed. We talked about Texas dropping the ball. It was Chris Paul's hamstring going into game 6.
People were not happy at you when you tweeted that.
I made that
People were really upset about. Even people who I didn't know followed you that I went to high school with were like, "Oh, nah, this is not it." I was like, "Oh, I didn't realize you followed my friend." Interesting.
Dude, that was one of the funniest reactions I've gotten in a long
time. People were not happy.
They were not happy at all about
it.
Yeah, we tell them what it is.
It's a sensitive time, Raheel. So Raheel made a meme of the infamous Chris Paul in his best Mufasa impression, laying down on the floor after his hammy exploded. Game, what was that? Game 5 of the Western Conference Finals 3 years ago.
Yep.
And he quote tweeted it with Texas as Chris Paul and COVID-19 as a player standing over him. I think it was right. And people were not happy.
Chris Paul, Texas. I just put Chris Paul, Texas, and quote tweeted Channel 13 or Harris County or somebody. People were not happy with me making jokes about that. It was like, guys, it happened. You guys were so close, and you guys hung a banner for that. So that's how it is, okay? That's how it is. You're going to catch some jokes when you lose like that. All right. The next person.
Report, baby.
Our next guest is somebody that is one of the funniest dudes on Twitter. And for those of you that don't know him,
I'm already here.
You already no, it's not you. You're like the seventh funniest guy. If that. I don't even know if you're seventh funniest. Oh no, it didn't. Hold on, hold on. Watch this. Let me line him up. Boom. Where's my man, StrosFan? Oh, it worked. There it is.
Wait, he's actually a fan?
He is actually a fan. His Twitter handle now is FanIKnow, but I know him as StrosFanIKnow. StrosFan, how you doing, buddy?
I'm making it, bro.
Man, how about this? Look, you're on the podcast. I told you I'm not going to show your face, and now you're on, baby. We got you.
Well, my
why are you hiding from us?
I couldn't show my face anyways.
He's not allowed. Yeah, why can't you show your face?
Well, because I said my iOS is too old, my operating system.
Come on now.
I don't think that's what it is.
I'll screenshot it next time, jerks.
Okay. All right. So we're going to do this with you.
My Twitter DM's always open for you, baby.
He's the best. So we're going to start the same five questions I ask every guest that's new to the show. So you ready for this, StrosFan?
Shoot.
All right. What's one song you wish everybody would listen to at least once in their life?
Poncho and Lefty. You don't even know what that is, do you?
I don't even know what that is.
Willie Nelson and Merle Haggard came out in like the late 70s, early 80s.
Okay. Fan is showing some range. All right. I like it.
Your boy has two Willie Nelson vinyls. You know that, right?
Yeah, but that's just for hipster purposes.
Yeah.
I
actually listened to it on Saturday. So, you know what? Recharging my Texas battery, StrosFan. All right. Your boy's still Texan. Okay. What's one thing you always have to have in your fridge?
Beer.
What kind?
I've been drinking that Natty Light.
Oh, do you hate yourself?
Dude, I'm a redneck. Y'all know this.
You're the most sophisticated redneck. All right. What's one place you want to visit that you haven't yet?
Rihanna's house.
Okay, you're not getting in there, bro, but good luck.
I don't know how secure her system is. You don't know.
I know when she puts out the new Fenty lineup pictures on Instagram, you're browsing them.
I don't have Instagram, so now when you stalk, you have to like go back and then open it back up again and find another picture. It's just terrible, dude.
Yeah, that's literally the only reason I downloaded Instagram again, because Instagram makes it impossible for you to explore through their website if you don't have the application.
Yeah, it's bullshit.
And then once you're finally on the app, if you click on one ad, you're screwed for the rest of the day. You're just going to see ads for that same thing over and over again. Instagram is the worst. I want to get back off it again, but I'm hooked.
Nah, I'm not going to download it for that reason. I do too much Twitter as it is. I don't need something else to distract me.
That's a good point. Okay, who's one person alive you want to meet and have coffee with?
One person alive. Probably George Springer.
Okay. You're going to convince him to take a hometown deal?
Or threaten him. But
Not Rihanna. So you don't want to have coffee with Rihanna?
I didn't want to say Rihanna again. All the answers to everything would be Rihanna if it was up to me. But
Rihanna in your fridge would be an odd thing. I'm not going to lie. That would be really strange, but yeah. I get it, kind of. It'd be really weird. Okay, what's one app you want to delete off your phone, but you just can't?
The KBO. You know when the KBO started playing, the Korean Baseball Organization? I downloaded the app to follow along, and now I don't know how to get it off my phone. I don't even want it.
Is your iOS that old? Do you forgot how to delete apps on it?
I don't know. I was talking to my brother, and he was like, you just got to double tap it a little. And I just it kept opening, and I was like, screw it. It can just stay there. I don't give a shit.
Dude, how about when the KBO announced that we're going to change everything. We're going to broadcast baseball games, and all you American fans are going to love this.
Yeah,
but the games are going to be on at like midnight or 2 a.m. So can you guys stay up, please? That'd be kind of cool.
I stayed up the first night because it was a midnight game.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm up anyways around that time. And then the next one was at 4 a.m. And I was just like, bro, I'm out. I can't. We can't do this. You know, people have been DVRing them and then, you know, watching them the next day. I can't do that because it's not live baseball. And no. The game I watched wasn't very good. It wasn't very good baseball.
Yeah, and like, what's the point of it? I mean, you're not, who are you talking to about KBO baseball? I know people try to make it a thing, and people are buying T-shirts. I know Lance purchased a T-shirt off of Amazon, and people are tweeting about it. But come on, you guys are just trying to fill a hole in your life with sports. And turns out that, like, it's all right. You don't have to fill it. Maybe try something else.
Oh, I have to fill it. But
you just wanted to say that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, not like that. Come on. No, I'm saying I need sports. I understand why we're not getting any. But, I mean, like, I need sports or else I'll just fill the rest of it up with, you know, drugs and alcohol. Nobody needs that.
All right. So, Stros fan, the one of the big reasons I brought you on is, one, we don't know that much about you. And the other one is because of Kolaches, and we're going to get to that in a second. But give us your backstory, man. Who are you?
Well, I'm from a little bitty 2A school about 50 miles west of Houston. Grew up out there, rednecking it up. And then got into oil and gas and made a whole bunch of money and then lost a whole bunch of money. And now I'm a stay-at-home uncle. That's the fan story. Yes.
How's that been?
At what point did you become a fan? At what point did you go from a human to a fan?
I was listening to a lot of sports talk radio. I'd never listened to sports talk radio before, but I didn't have anything to do in the mornings on a drive to, I was working in Hallettsville and I was living in Bonbrook Plantation. You know where that is, Raheel. And so I was driving back and forth, and I didn't have anything to listen to. So I started listening to sports talk, and you can't listen to sports talk without Twitter because everything is on Twitter. So yeah. I downloaded Twitter, and at the time, see, I'm the reason the Astros are good now. Because at the time, this was in 2015, the first time they made the playoffs. They sucked in 2014. So when I downloaded it, they were terrible. And so it was kind of like a play on, hey, look, I'm a Stros fan. And when they're like, oh, I know. You know what I mean? So it was just dumb. Nobody knew what they're doing when they first joined Twitter. And it just stuck. Somebody sent me a picture of their ceiling fan. It was like, this should be your ABI. I was like, well, there it is, buddy.
It's not even your ceiling fan.
No, that's not even my ceiling fan.
What?
The guy on Twitter, he goes, man, it's so weird seeing my ceiling fan all the time.
Like, yeah. Yeah, what? Those of you who listen on audio and don't know Stros fan, his Twitter after fan, like an actual ceiling fan for the longest time. And I was like, you, Jose, I just assumed he one day was just laying in bed and he's like, oh, I gotta put some kind of picture up there, and I'll take the one next to the AC vent. So that's a good fan right there. And boom, there it is.
Nope, some dude named Andrew.
Man. So then from there, you just started. You are a sports radio favorite now. You interact with most of the hosts. That's how I got to know you. It's just our interactions during the show and sometimes afterwards, because you would listen to the podcast a little bit later. You've built this like little fan community that we're almost like your groupies because we love your content.
Oh, come on now. I'm blushing. You can't see me because my phone's so old, but I'm blushing.
Damn, bro, get a new phone.
Please.
Raheel,
give him one of your phones. Give him one of your baby phones.
I can't see half of the emojis. And people are like sending me emojis. Like, I can't see that. Don't send that to me. Yo. No, I mean, I've got, you know, if they would quit perma banning my accounts, I'd probably have a lot more followers, but I'm not really in it for the followers. There's like a couple hundred folks I like, and as long as I can interact with them, we're good.
So how did you get perma banned the first time?
I don't know.
You don't know?
They didn't send you an email or something?
They sent me an email saying out, but it didn't like tell me which tweet it was. So
interesting.
I don't know. I got into it with a Dodgers fan and I was wasty faced. And like real late at night, like 2 o'clock in the morning. And apparently the next day people were texting me and was like, hey, you got banned because you got into it with this Dodgers fan. Now he's tweeting about how he's on the phone with Twitter trying to get you banned. I was like, okay.
Whoa. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, he's one of those.
Why?
And the second time I got caught for running from the police, they literally sent me an email and said, you were trying to evade a permanent ban. And I was like, well, yeah.
I mean, so somebody re-snitched on you and told them that, hey, this guy that you banned, has this, because did you use the same email? Like, how do they find out?
This was the same email. I should not have done
that. Oh, you dummy.
I'm finding out now. Well, I mean, I'm telling, I'm a redneck. I'm not good with electronics.
Damn, that's wild, bro. That Twitter is like, come on, who cares? Just let them on. You're not spreading hate messages. You're not rigging an election. You're not doing it. You're just talking trash. Yeah, this is the stuff you would do at a bar.
They're banning folks for just so much dumb stuff now. And yet, I get death threats weekly on Twitter, and nothing happens. Of course, I don't report them because I don't care that much about anybody that's threatening my life. But it's just so dumb. They've gotten so dumb.
Hey, what's the most annoying thing you hear on sports radio? Because I want to ask some sports radio questions to you. You are a diehard listener.
John McClane.
John's the nicest guy. I think by law, every
he's dumber than a box of rocks.
I think every sports media person has to say that by law. When you first do a show, they go, hey, look, if anybody says anything about John McClane, positive or negative, you got to say he's one of the nicest guys.
Look, I'm sure.
But he really is.
He brings nothing to any show he's ever been on.
I'm sorry. Whole segments. Have you not seen the now famous GIF of him rolling his eyes at Radio Row? Don't say he doesn't bring anything to the table.
Yeah, Seth should beat the shit out of that dude. But anyway.
That was a fight. Oh. Man, I wish that fight would have gone down. That would have been fun.
God, it would have been so good.
Okay, what sports radio personality do you think doesn't get enough attention?
You.
Oh. Thank you. I appreciate that.
For real, though, I've listened to the maybe 2 hours of the bench since you left.
Really? Same here.
Yeah, it's just like, it's not funny anymore. There's not like a bunch of irreverent humor. There's not you laughing like an idiot in the background. It's just, they just like talk about sports, and I'm so tired of hearing about how, all of Lance's stories, they get on my nerves. So, yeah.
Hey. So listen to the bench, 7 to 11 a.m. Still and support
Meltzer,
my guys.
Meltzer's good. I like
Meltzer. Meltzer is good.
So yeah, basically everybody that doesn't have a job, I like.
Yeah, isn't that, that's weird. That's it's like the Stros fan death curse.
I like Gallant. You're fired up there in Seattle, boy.
Oh man, he loves Seattle. My man loves it.
He's living his best life. He's on the Seahawks flagship. He gets to talk to Pete Carroll every week.
Yeah, he's living it up there.
Okay, what do you think? What's one change? If I said Stros fan, you get to make one change in the Houston sports radio scene, not lineup changes, but anything else. All right, because lineup changes, they're not going to change. I'm just telling you right now.
Right.
All right. Look, there's white people love white personalities, guys. I'm sorry. That's just the way it is.
Yep.
So we're not going to change lineups, but. What is something else that you would change?
Like, what if you're not changing the lineup? What I'm going to change the time slots or something?
Anything else? The way they do the shows, listen to the shows, more or less Twitter, whatever it is.
The Twitter stuff doesn't bother me, because I can just go check whatever they're saying. But I guess, since a lot of the shows are 4 hours, and I listen to, when I'm around the house doing everything, I listen to a bunch of shows. And so it gets repetitive because I know like the average guy only listens to like 30 minutes or something. So getting the same news over and over again, but I know that's a me thing because I'm always listening.
Yeah. Okay. Can you tell us what is a difference between a kolache and a whatever the other thing is called?
I absolutely can.
Okay. Please go.
All right. Everybody just buckle in here for a second. I am sick and tired of cultural appropriation. Look, my grandparents or my great-grandparents came over here, and basically the Czech people in Central Texas started this kolache thing that has spread across the nation like COVID, saying that everything with bread stick something in some bread, it's a kolache. It's not a damn kolache. Kolaches have fruit in them. Now, they can be on top of them, it can be around them, any sort of bread. That is a kolache. Fruit, cream cheese, poppy seed. Brisket is hashtag not a kolache. Cheese is hashtag not a kolache. The jalapeno cheddar that you get at the store at the kolache shop, those are damn good. Hashtag not a kolache. So those are kielbasnik. I don't expect y'all to learn what the hell a kielbasnik is. Call it a pig in a blanket. Call it anything else you fucking want to. It's hashtag not a kolache. And I'm sick of it. And when people on the internet are like, this is my favorite bit that you do. It's not a bit, boys. call my Czech grandma. She'll tell you real damn quick.
So what I get at the Shipley's Donut with my iced coffee isn't a kolache.
No.
It's a glorified pigs in a blanket.
It's a pigs in a blanket. Call it, I don't care what they call it. Call it bread and meat. Make up a name for it. I don't care. It's not a kolache. So quit calling it a kolache. And if that's the one thing, I caught two people yesterday in a thread. One of them almost typed out kolache and then went, a kielbasnik. And the other one was like, yeah, I kielbasnik. And I was like, see, it's working.
You're slowly changing the world. Okay.
I'm slowly changing the world, yes.
Do actual Czechs eat poppy seed kolaches? Because nobody eats those, right?
Oh, my God. They're top two. Cream cheese and poppy seed are 1 and 1A. Dude, poppy seed kolache. Go get you a poppy seed kolache.
I did.
Or a poppy seed kolache?
From Hruska's.
Really? And you didn't like it?
No.
From what? Excuse me?
Oh, my God. Hruska's.
Hruska's. It's... Hey, Jose, I'm part of the culture.
Yeah. I decided it was okay.
I've spent so much time there because every time you go to Austin, driving there for when I was going to school, you have to stop there. Like, it is... If you don't stop there, you get a ticket, all right? You've got to stop there. It is the best kolache I've ever had. Is that the best kolache for you?
No. The best kolaches I've had are – actually, they're sweet rolls. But
so they're not kolaches.
No. Ooh. I like the sweet rolls of this place better than I like their kolaches, but their kolache is really good too. It's a place called Country Bakery with a K, which is sketch. Mm. But in Hallettsville, and they have the best sweet rolls. In fact, if you look them up, they have a website and you can order like pies, dewberry pies, and all sorts of Czech delicacies, and they'll ship it out to you.
Where's Hallettsville?
Chip.
Lavaca County. I don't know, that probably doesn't help. It's just northeast of Victoria. Maybe just east of Victoria.
That sounds too far. So you got like an inconvenience.
Head
down 69 the whole way?
It's on 90. Alternate 90, you know, the one that goes to Rosenberg.
Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. I got you.
Yeah.
I got you.
Yeah, down there.
Are you still in the Richmond Rosenberg area? Yes or no?
No, I'm in Stafford now.
Okay. Stafford. How's it been?
I grew up. Shit, I don't care. You know where Wallace is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I grew up in Wallace.
Okay.
So I've lived around Richmond and I've lived in Bonbrook. I've lived in Greatwood. You know, I lived in Pecan Grove, and so
shout out to Pecan Grove for putting up free Christmas lights.
Shout out to the Grove.
Love the Grove. Love the Grove. How's it been raising twins in the pandemic?
It's been really, you know, just swells my. It's been terrible, bro. they don't listen, and you know they're bouncing off the damn walls and. They're stuck in the house. You know, we got them a redneck pool, so that helps. But they're little.
How old are they?
8.
Yeah, that's a hard no for me, bro.
Yeah, they're
people. Something. You're a good uncle, man, because a lot of people say that, like, you know, my nephew is like my kid. And shout out to my uncles. Like, they really, like, I am their son. They are my dad and all that stuff.
Right.
But Raheel, Rams, and Ollie, like, if you put my twin nephews in my house for the last 3 months, I'm out, bro. Like, that, I'm sorry, man. Those are my wife's kids now.
Right. It is just, and my brother and his wife, they're, you know, essential. So they go to work every day and like 6 days a week. So it's just me and them, man. And
damn.
I usually just wake up in the morning, open my door, try to go back to bed. And then just wait for the first scream. This morning, one of them, Twin A, threw a damn huge-ass transformer at Twin B's head. There was blood. I mean, And then he said, he kicked me. I said, is that an appropriate response? Are we in the Middle East? What's going on here?
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, easy, Dave Portnoy. God.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's just, you know, like, we'll just bomb the shit out of you if you do a little anything to us. God dang, man. Oh, your brother's bleeding here.
Please stop cussing.
Man, that is wild. Man, see, that's what I'm saying. These kids, like, that's how we were. When my brother and I used to fight, and I mean, I used to kick my sister in the face up until I was like 18. But that's how kids are. I don't want to deal with that. No, not anymore. Not anymore. I told this story last week. My sister, she lives in Atlanta now. So I was dropping stuff off and we almost got robbed.
Oh, yeah. I heard. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't, no big deal. But your boy here, you know, watching so many FBI shows and all that, I knew what that guy was doing. And I watched The Wire, which is in Baltimore. But, yeah. You know, Atlanta is like Baltimore of the South. So,
pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. I knew what was happening. So I me being the detective that I am, I stepped in and nothing happened, so it's all good. Jose, you got anything for Stros?
What's do we know what the do we have a lined up network for when not if when you get banned again? Is there a are there backup accounts? Is what I'm asking.
Well, there's still Fan You Know with a U. I've looked into this. People have sent me these too. Yeah, but I might have to like. Use a different email, of course. This one that I'm on now is actually because that was just idiotic of me. I was like, oh, they'll never find me again. A big tech firm.
Yeah.
Now there's Fan You Know with a U. I already blew through Stros Fan You Know. I might just there's an account that's just at Fan and it hasn't tweeted since like 2011. So I might try to hack into that.
Man, go
didn't
for
get
it.
Purged.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're like some media company or something like that, but I haven't tweeted since 2011. So
try calling them up and see what happens. You know, Twitter, for as big of a company as they are, when I was doing social media, I used the same email for really, really big accounts, and they didn't care. Like it was my email on 10 different accounts. They didn't. All you had to do was change up like one letter or one period. So if my email was the Raheel, and you put the dot Raheel, th dot e Raheel, you could use that same email over and over again and you get the notification. So there's a little hacks that you could use the same email.
I'm gonna just DM you. We're gonna figure this out.
I got you, bro. You know me, man. I get around I get hacks and I get around things on Twitter. That's what I do for a living. Or I did for a living. Yeah. Hey, well, I want to ask you before I let you go and we have to wrap up the show. This last month of the protests of all the great things that are happening in our country in terms of finally people are talking about it and the awareness. What's that been like for you to watch this?
Really happy. I mean, I don't know what other adjective to use. I mean, I'm pretty, you know, pretty lefty guy and I don't really try to hide it on Twitter or anywhere else, even though I live in Texas. But, you know, just people that are just absolutely slamming other people for saying dumb shit and stuff. Now I'm sorry. You know, just like before, like the Portnoy stuff. Like, we've been new. You know what I mean? Like, everybody knew. A lot of us didn't like Barstool because of that. And, you know, now they're like, oh, it's cancel culture. Good. Some of them need to be canceled. Mm-hmm. That's just all there is to it.
Let me pause you there, because I have thoughts on this real quickly. I have to get these off my chest. The whole thing about, like, what are you trying to cancel with Barstool? Because their fans are not going to leave. That's why they love that. Like, as you mentioned, I don't like that website and I don't like their content because of the way they present it and because of the stuff they say. So I'm not going to, like, me canceling it, who am I canceling it? Their sponsorships, because they're not pulling out because they knew what they were getting into. All the big money that Barstool brought in, the big investment. If that firm or if that company didn't know what Barstool was beforehand, that's on them. I'm pretty sure they did their research and like they know what they're signing up for.
Sure, but can they not be shamed either out of it now or in
Dude, they don't care.
Early or
You saw him already. Like, he's already using this as a as bringing in more subscribers and more readers.
Right, and you know, I can understand that, but I mean, they're dropping Tucker's ads are dropping left and right. People are pulling out of Fox. The you know, not the news side of it, but the opinion side of it. And you know, even if I'm not saying take down their website or put them in jail or nothing like, all I'm saying is now people can look and see what it is. You know, I think a lot of people now. I was talking to, with this guy last night about it. Like when I said we've been new about Barstool, people are stopping going, wait a second. What exactly did he say? Or what exactly is he meaning by this? Or what exactly is this company? Or what exactly, you know, they're stopping because people are going, you know, Black Lives Matter. This stuff's happening in the streets. You know, this is real. We have cameras now. We can see this. And so now people are stopping and going, you know what? That you shouldn't talk like that. You shouldn't do this. And maybe it'll drive people off, you know, if there's 15 people that go, you know what? I don't want to consume his media anymore because of his views on things, then good. I'm just saying, let's get all this out in the open.
I'm good with that. And the only reason I'm bringing up, like, what exactly are we canceling with Barstool? And this is a conversation, by the way, you and I have had before regarding one of the pitchers, right? And when he was 17 or 16, he tweeted something racist. And you and I had a back and forth
Josh
about
Hader
this.
From the Brewers.
Was that right? It was Josh Hader after the All-Star game?
Yeah, it was Hader, yeah.
Yeah, and my whole thing was like, yes, I'm opposed to everything that is negative and hateful. I don't like it. That's not me. But when we actually sit down and go, what exactly are we canceling? Are we canceling, you know, like that? Then it gets weird because if it's something old, are we canceling future opportunities because of something he did? And then you can counter with, well, are people allowed to change? Yes or no? You know, and that's, this is just a discussion. I'm with you, by the way, like whatever it is, let's please do it because Barstool is annoying as hell sometimes and a lot of times. So what exactly are we canceling? That's just my point I wanted to make.
It's a completely fair, you know, question and everything else. I just I'm about shining light on stuff. I mean, at 17, if I was held responsible for stuff that I did when I was 17, I wouldn't be able to vote now. Oh wait.
Oh yeah. Ooh, that's a touchy subject.
Interesting.
Yeah. Good job, Jose. Now
does Lena know about these things?
Shh, don't tell Lena nothing, bro. Keep it down.
Good job, Stros fan. You know what? Now you can't cancel out Jose's MAGA vote. So,
wait, what? Hold on! Don't even put that. Don't even put that shit on me.
Jose got mad at me because I'm friends with Will Kane.
He's friends with Will Kane, who got wrapped in circles by Bomani Jones on his way out with his tail between his legs.
I heard
that's his buddy.
Dude.
Will Kane has been nothing. Like, I'm dead ass serious. Will Kane.
I don't think he knows your. I don't think he knows your ethnic background. I think that's
He does. We've had a
I don't think so.
No, I've had a talk with him about it. Will Kane is one of the coolest dudes, and he's done more. I'm not even joking. Like, he gave me a bigger platform than people we know. Like, I don't want to say names because I don't want to start. But
King?
Will Kane's awesome. Okay. Will Kane's a good dude. He's a good dude.
You can't just be friends with people that have the exact same views as you.
Yeah, Jose.
I'm friends with people. I mean, lifelong friends. My best friend is a crazy MAGA guy. I mean, but we either just don't talk politics or I tell him facts and then he goes, yeah, well, I still like him. And I go, all right, bud, let's go fishing.
Well, now you know? I know what the K in your Twitter handle is for.
Ooh, got him. But that is the thing, Jose. You brought up a good point. Like, Bomani Jones, he is so damn good at his job. He has done everything right in terms of what you want a show to do, and that show got canceled. Mm-hmm. And you're like, well, dude, this is one of the big things in sports media is there's a black guy who is awesome at his job, and he's done everything right, and his show's gone. And you'll see white dudes, hell, a dude just got out of jail for ticket fraud, and WFAN, he's going to get back, like, hey, here's your show again because of ratings. It's like, damn, see, that is one of the big things. Like, that's what we're talking about here when it comes to privilege and opportunities.
Yeah, and we also need more people of color listening to sports talk radio. I mean, because it's, you know, mainly
but they are, man. They are at ESPN, at least. I've seen the numbers. You look at my Twitter followers that I've gained from ESPN, and it was shocking how many people of color are actually listening. But you know, some people just understand that. Some people don't believe that. So I'll leave it at that because I don't want to get into that whole. I don't want to get into that. Well, dude, I appreciate you taking some time out, man. Thank you so much. You entertain us a lot, and you heard me say the words, man. I think you're freaking brilliant, and I really think you could do a podcast or a radio show if you wanted.
No,
I don't. Like I said, I'm inept when it comes to anything like that technologically, but I appreciate.
You wouldn't know how to. You wouldn't know how to hook up a microphone anywhere, Raheel. Come on.
No, I would not.
Are you? Do you have wired headphones on right now?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
So do I.
Yeah, but so do I. But it's not my mic. It's just because I have to use poor headphones for this expensive mic.
Okay.
Well, Stros Fan, thank you so much. Make sure you guys follow him at FanIKnow. That's his current account. And it might change by the time you listen to this episode. So just follow us on Twitter and we'll tweet it out. Thank you so much, buddy.
No problem, man.
All right, there he is, Stros Fan. Bye, Fan. He's so awesome. All right, Jose. Anything else we miss between us two?
The Boys season 2, baby. September.
So why?
I don't like September. How they're releasing it.
Why? What are they doing different?
So they're doing 3 episodes on launch day and then 1 episode every week.
Oh, so they're doing Mandalorian style.
Sort of, yeah.
Okay, because that one was 2 episodes, one on the opening week.
Yeah,
and then
that
one
was,
per
that's
week, right.
It was 2 episodes. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's what the Boys are doing. But I'm excited. One of the best TV shows of last year. And they had, by the time it wrapped, because it's been about a year since it came out. It came out around 4th of July. By the time it wrapped, they were pretty much done with season 2. So with filming season 2. So it's out in September finally.
So did I start The Boys late? Because I feel like I just watched it. Or did I watch it when it first
came out? We watched it in the summer. We talked about it in the summer.
Yeah.
It came out around 4th of July, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, because we watched it after Stranger Things for sure. Because we had
Stranger Things. Oh, yeah, that's right. Because Stranger Things came out on 4th of July. No?
Yeah, it did. 4th of July weekend.
Didn't season 2 come out? On 4th of July, I'm all mixed up now.
I thought last year it came out 4th of July because Nike had the big drop of season 3.
Right, no, you're right. Yeah. The boys came out July 26th, so we were talking about it in August.
Okay, that's right. Okay, so that's why. That's right.
That makes sense.
It is going to be July. Like in a couple of days. I think that's why like time is just it's gotten so slow, but yet
time doesn't exist.
Yeah, time is just what was it? Time is just a circle.
A societal construct.
Yeah. The other thing I want to tell you, I said I would go back and listen to some of the albums that were in the top 25 albums of the year so far. I did listen to Perfume Genius.
Oh, did you?
I lasted 2 songs and I ejected, bro.
What is it like?
It's old school lyrical song. I mean, he's just singing. It's not. I don't know. But I think I just have to sit down and listen to it again because what happens is if I'm in the mood for something and I don't like it immediately, I'm out. Like that's it. I'm not wasting time. I'd rather go listen to something else. So I just need to power through it.
Oh God, it has a long description on Apple Music. So you quit after the second song, you said?
Second song, yeah. I was out. I'm sorry. Like, what am I going to do?
It's not my feelings you're hurting. It's Perfume Genius's feelings.
Yeah, I know, but it was the podcast. I said I would do it. Okay, anything else? I think we covered everything. Thank you, everyone. We did go a little bit longer. People, for whatever reason, Jose, do not like the longer episodes. Like, everyone's so accustomed.
Really?
The listenership falls off. Not that much, but just a little bit on the longer episodes. And I'm like, guys, it's just one more. Because I think because the whole basis of the show was it was going to be you can listen to it on your drive in and your drive back. And that was it. Like, we don't want more than that commitment. And when you go half an hour, it gets a little bit longer.
Yeah. And it was literally also, okay, we have literally an hour window to tape this. Let's knock it out.
Now we have nothing.
All we have is time.
Time again is just a circle. Okay, Spicy Boy masks are coming. Make sure you follow me on Instagram at Raheel Doing Things. I will put information up there. First dibs on that website. I only made 50, and because I don't want to deal with it. I'm hand sending.
Plenty of them
each
are
one.
Mine. So
I got yours coming. Yes, I'm gonna come drop off your CBD, your Alamo Remedy CBD.
Let's
I gotta
go.
Drop that off in the mask for you as well. Okay, Jose, thank you so much, buddy. I will talk to you next week.
Sounds good, man. Stay spicy.